Hi everyone. Today's video is the first of my kind of properly basic things, a kind of introduction to rats. I'm doing this video to talk about why you should get rats and some of the real basics you should think about before getting them. This may be useful for people that have just got rats as well, but probably more useful for those that haven't so far. So I'm going to look at why rats. So rats are not suitable for everybody, and I'll kind of go into what you should think about before you get them. How many, a very important topic, where you should look to get them from, and some of the pitfalls that you can encounter there. What sex you should get, which would be an interesting one because there isn't a right answer on it. What do I need to get the rats as well? So that's what I'm going to try and cover. We shall see how long it takes. If you hear any bangs or see any disruptive influences, the girls are out, so they're no doubt going to be causing mischief. And I'll be keeping an eye out because they usually do something they shouldn't. So if you hear any bangs or crashes, I might vanish and come back shortly. So, why rats? I think the first thing to talk about is the fact they really aren't suitable for everybody. Rats are small animals, so they live in cages, which is great. It's very convenient in a lot of ways. You don't have to go out and walk them as such, but they do take quite a bit of time. Rats do very well with human attention, and whilst you don't absolutely have to give them it every day, they will benefit from it. Sorry, fingers just found something on free range and has a mouthful. That is the other thing to mention. When you spend time with the rats or let them play or do things, and they will thrive on everything you can throw at them, they tend to get up to no good quite a lot. And you may witness this as the rats are free ranging whilst I'm doing this video and see things like things clearly found some food. I have no idea whether they've just broken into the food tub. I will have to investigate later. They're all probably going to get fat if so. Owning rats is a challenge. It's something I would not be without, and I don't want a pet that I can just put somewhere and know that it'll be still be there when I come back. I want a rat that will test me, will get up to no good, and basically challenge me just as much as I challenge them. It's part of the joy of owning rats for me. But if you're very house proud, if you don't have any area in the house you can make safe, and there are ways of making them safe, you're not prepared to put in that work, and you're protective of a lot of your possessions, clothes, that kind of thing, then they're not the pet for you. Whatever rat proofing I've put in place, at some point they've defeated it. Some of that's because I'm a bit stupid and forget to, let's say, close the door properly on a cupboard and they're in the rat food again. Some of it's because they've worked out ways around my rat proofing. They're not cheap, they are destructive, they are awesome. You're not going to get a more intelligent small animal, or one that will form that same depth of bond with you, I would say. And I absolutely love owning rats. I've owned them now for, well, over 30 years. I can't work out exactly how much because I'm dyslexic and a bit crap at counting. But I would not be without them. They've kind of really helped shape my life, and they're very cheeky, nosy little things, and very affectionate when they want to be. But one of the key things is when they want to be. Sometimes they want to run around and explore, sometimes they want to destroy something, sometimes they want to shove things off work surface, and sometimes they want to just lick you and sit there, and it's lovely. I wouldn't have it any other way because I quite like it when they choose me, but I wouldn't want them to choose me all the time because that would be a bit boring. Different rats from different places and kind of different temperaments will react in different ways. I've got licky rats, I've got explorey rats, I've got very, very calm rats. That's part of the joy of them. But it also means that when you own rats, you should try and come to it without a preconceived notion of how that pet should behave. They're so variable and they have such strong characters. Give them the chance to be themselves, and you'll find that they can kind of really be absolutely wonderful pets. Just do naughty things like try and steal my notes. Luna decided they were bedding material. On that subject, I should also mention one of the biggest downsides of rats, which is the emotional impact. These lovely little animals live on average about 24 months, so about 2 years. There's been various studies, and it ranges from 21 months to 26 months, 27 months. You'll hear some people claim an awful lot more than that. In reality, on average, they do live about 2 years, and that's not long for a rat that oh, sorry, for an animal that you will intently bond with. It's one of their real downsides, and I've seen a lot of people when they lose their first, thank you, Mark, when they lose their first rats, not come back not get more after that. It's too much for them. So be aware of that, and be aware that you will have to learn to deal with loss and to deal with kind of challenges and struggles, even as you have to deal with cheeky little girls that are lovely and affectionate. Well worth it, but be aware and make sure they are for you. In terms of why to get them, I mean, I've mentioned a bit about their intelligence. They're very, very trainable. They're very, very interesting pets. They're very, very challenging pets. You can do so much for them and learn so much. I mean, one of the things I absolutely love doing for them is all the enrichment that I put in their cage, and I'll properly go through it at some point. But you can see them on the digging box at the moment, wondering what on earth I'm doing. And they're very inquisitive, very, very inquisitive creatures. And they do make your life a lot more interesting. They're lovely to watch and also lovely to interact with. Definitely the right pet for some people. And they do make excellent children's pets if those children are happy to have an animal that will wander off and do something, that won't just sit on their knee and be cuddled. If they want that kind of pet, a guinea pig's great. So, covered the why, deciding whether you're right for rats and the rats are right for you. How many? This is a very important topic. One rat is not enough. There are very, very, very limited cases in my 30 plus years of rat ownerships where I've seen a rat that genuinely is better off on its own, and I can probably count them on one hand. I've seen a lot of rats and known a lot of people with rats, not just my own. Rats are far happier in a group, and sometimes they need help to settle in that group. You need to introduce them properly. You need to, in some cases, if they've got kind of hormonal issues, you might need to castrate or spay them. You might need to spend a bit of time finding the right friends for them, but almost always rats are happier in a group. Whilst it's clear they can love people, as Monster's demonstrating, she does quite like me. While it's clear that they can love people, and when they do see you, they're overjoyed to see you. When they're on their own, you can't be there all the time, and there's nothing like a rat friend. Once you've seen them snuggled up together, it's amazing. So we know they need more than one. Socially, actually, there's been lab studies that have shown that rats kept on their own kind of become addicted to substances more easily. So there is actually a medical reasons why they need kind of company as well. It causes proper psychological changes, which they don't enjoy. You do sometimes have fun with them. They can fight and scrap, but they're so interesting to watch together. So more than one, how many? When you're starting out, it's a good idea, I would say, generally, to plan for losing one at some point. You will lose one at some point. Sometimes it can happen earlier than you're expecting, and they don't do well on their own even when they've lived most of their lives with other rats. Quite often they can grieve to death, and I've actually had a rat that was kind of a hair's breadth from basically killing herself because she refused to eat. She wouldn't move. She'd come and see me and give me a lick, and then she'd just go back to her bed and mourn because she lost her sister. It took us touring every single pet shop in the location. This was quite a few years ago, and I'll talk why there are better options than pet shops later. But at the time, this was going to save her life, and it was the only thing we could do. We finally found a rat. It took us about a week to introduce them very, very badly because we didn't know what we were doing back then. But it worked out and it saved her. And I don't doubt if we'd have left it maybe half a week longer, she wouldn't have made it. She was already lost a massive amount of her body weight. Not every rat will react as violently as that and kind of tear themselves apart, but they will all be a hell of a lot more miserable without their friends. So planning for that happening, planning for one of the rats not making it, is very, very useful. And what I would tend to advise is aim to start off with three if you can, and a cage that's the right size for two, the right size for one, is going to be the right size for three to four. That's the really, four is probably the minimum size cage you want to buy for. So thank you, Monster, she's a sweetheart. So you want to look to get ideally three to start with. If you're struggling and you can only get two, or even if you have got the three, start thinking about, after about a year, about adding a couple of babies. Because not only do adding a couple of babies create you what I'd call a rolling group, which means that when you then lose another two rats, or your original two or three rats, then you can add another pair of babies and so on. So this kind of plans for the future, you will always have a nice small group of rats. You might want to increase that group size, but that's the kind of minimum rolling group I'd do. Add about every year or when you're down to two rats. Not only does that, but adding youngsters to the group is really lovely. It gives the kind of oldies a really new lease of life. They're pinging all over the place. You do have to get the introductions right, and I'll do a video at some point on that, but it's well worth it. And watching the social kind of dynamics and hierarchy, it's, I'd say the optimum group size, in my opinion, and it varies by person, is probably around about 5 or 6 for that. It's really, really nice to see how they interact with each other. So that's probably one to think about. Just bear in mind that there can be too many rats for one person. I would recommend, until you really know how you're going to deal with the end of life, don't go much above 4 to 6. If you add rats very, very quickly, maybe add, I don't know, 6 to 10, 6 babies or something, all the same age, and then add another 6 in a little while, and suddenly you're up to 12, and then they start dying, it can really hit you hard. If you know that you're going to be fine with that, and some people have kept many other animals in the past and are fully au fait with how they're going to cope with that kind of thing, it can be fine, you know yourself. But if you've not dealt with it before, be careful, because I've seen a lot of people leave owning rats because they've lost too many in a short time period, and it's just really not them. I mean, these animals are very special, very precious, and you kind of you have to understand how much it's going to hurt when you do lose them. Right, so next bit of the question is, where are you going to get them from? So there are 3 main options in terms of getting your rats from different places. So the first one, which is incidentally your client, which is a breeder. There are many different breeders in the country. They breed in many different ways. They have different ethics. Not every breeder is the same. So just saying go to a breeder is not sufficient. I would always recommend, along with kind of a good rescue, which I'll talk about next, one of the best options to get rats from to start off with, you might say I'm biased on this, but I thought this before I started breeding, is from a good breeder. And that means the kind of person who will breed for temperament. They will breed to try and improve the rats. They will breed with health in mind. They will keep good records and make decisions based on what's best for the rats involved. Generally speaking, they will also be active in the fancy. So what I mean by that is there's a kind of showing breeding group of people, and I'm quite active, and it's quite a good thing in the UK. They will help each other out. They will share ideas. They will share information. They will share rats quite often. One of my girls, who's over the other side of the room, otherwise I'd thrust her in front of you, is from another breeder who gave her to me to help with my lines. I gave her a rat back, which is the sister of one of my rats in here. And we've done that to try and help advance rats as a whole. And that's why, for me, being part of the fancy is important. So a good first step when you're looking for a breeder is to look on the NFRS breeders list. So that's the National Fancy Rat Society breeder list. This is obviously relevant to people in the UK. If you're watching from elsewhere, ask questions, ask who's involved with things, and see where you get to from there. There is also other local clubs. So I'm part of the North of England Rat Society. There is the Midlands Rat Club. There is the Yorkshire Rat Club as well. So I think they're the 3. I think the others aren't. London and Southern Rat and Mouse Club, or Mouse and Rat Club. But again, they will have their own breeders list, and they will be people that in theory are active in the fancy. I will say none of those lists check the breeders. It's still up to you to go and have a chat with those breeders, find out whether their ethics fit with what you think. This is my rat from another breeder, little Luna from Halcyon. Yeah, you have to make sure that they fit with what you want from a breeder, and what everybody wants changes. But one thing to bear in mind with that, and anybody that's selling rats, including pet shops or even from rescues, is make sure the rats are old enough to go to a new home. Now, 6 weeks is the absolute minimum in terms of what the NFRS says. So that gives them a week after weaning. That week is very important. I'll talk more about it when I do some videos on breeding, probably in the new year now, because I'm not going to have litters until then. But make sure they're at least 6 weeks. Personally, I prefer to home 7, 8 weeks-ish. It depends on the rats and how they're growing. There isn't an absolute right number. It does depend on your family that you're dealing with. But 5 weeks is too soon. You want to give them at least a week after being split from their mum, from weaning, from being split from their siblings, before taking them home. That's probably one of the most fundamental bits. And then you need to pick somebody that you're happy with, the ethics in terms of how they breed, what they breed for, who they breed. You also want to get to know their family. So my rats are not suitable for everybody. Sorry, somebody's trying to steal my notes page again. My rats are, I like to breed for naughty, active, intelligent rats. Some people want rats that are a bit more cuddly, calmer, less likely to destroy the world. It's your own choice on that one, but make sure you breed them and have a chat to the breeders and get what's right for you. And a good breeder won't mind you chatting to them and then perhaps finding some rats that are more suited to you, just as long as you're upfront with them and don't kind of waste loads of their time with it. So breeders are good options. There are some very dodgy breeders out there. Be careful, ask the questions and you'll be sorted. And you can also turn up to shows. That's a great way to meet people, because you actually get to meet the rats and chat to them in person, and they're usually fairly local breeders as well if you go to a show that's quite close to you. When I say quite close, my closest show is 20 minutes away. I've been to shows 4 hours away before. It's great. Sorry, this is Ellie. She's whose sister I sent to another breeder. Aren't you, Elle? So that's breeders. Next really good option is rescues. Rescues should not be discounted. They can often be absolutely lovely rats. It really varies. A lot of them are born from pet shop missexing accidents, where the wrong sex has been homed and then they've had babies, and often those babies are raised in loving homes and well handled. The same if there's kind of any incidents like that where people have got it wrong, or rats are rescued. So they often have a fairly good start in life. Genetically they're risky, because you don't know what the health's going to be like and you don't know if they're going to have hormonal problems. But if you get them a little bit older as well, you can get rescues year old, 2 years old, you can get them quite late on. They'll have quite known temperaments. There are rat specific rescues out there. They're the best option if you're new to rats, because they will help kind of match the right kind of rats to you. If you know your rats a little bit better, then you can go on things like Rat Rescue Network UK, which is a Facebook group that I'm involved in, and that has quite a lot of rescues that come up regularly on there, all looking for the right kind of homes. And you just have to read around a bit and ask questions to make sure you're getting the right rats from that. And then there is also places like the RSPCA and so on. I would say, particularly with the RSPCA, it varies a lot as to whether they know what they're talking about or whether they don't. They don't have a lot of experience with rats generally, and that's perfectly fine. You know, they deal with a lot of animals and a lot more dogs and cats. But you may have to like learn a lot yourself before you're getting from them from there, and make sure you know what you're doing when you're choosing them. Some rescue rats do have problems. They do come with kind of real ingrained problems from harsh treatment, from being left on their own a long time. They may need a particular style of handling. I would recommend, unless you're quite used to reading animal body language and dealing with potentially getting bitten and such, don't go for an older rescue that has problems, as like regularly bites and such. Not everybody tells kind of. You can get some lovely rats that have been kind of biters, and that actually just need to be handled properly and respectfully, and they'll be fine. But it's, if you're not very experienced, again, it can be really hard work, and you do have to put in the time and be prepared to get potentially bitten a few times. It's not as bad as it seems. The first time you're kind of heartbroken that you've upset the rats badly, and you're usually bleeding a bit too. When they bite and the mean business, it can be bad. But you know, you get used to it. But there's less kind of guarantees in terms of temperament. Generally, if you get a rat from a good breeder line, you will know what the temperament's going to be like. They'll be well handled, be consistent. If you get a rat from a rescue, it's always a risk, unless you kind of, they're older rescues and you really know them. So the final option is pet shops. This is one that kind of upsets a lot of people, because most people have got rats from pet shops at some point. I started out with rats from pet shops. I've had rescues, I've had them from breeders, I've done them all, been there, done that. And for a lot of people, not in the ear, sorry, this is really, really tickly. No, really not in the ear, that's mean. Yes, it is. Sorry, rats are asses. I'm just going to defend my ear from Mog. Yeah, so the reason that pet shops, I would not advise people to go from them. It's a bit like rescues, they're entirely random. But whereas with rescues you're helping out a rat in real need, in with pet shops you're effectively paying, you're basically paying the pet shop to continue to produce rats in that kind of condition. And yes, she is actually trying to eat my ear now. This is not fun. She's also wildly on heat, which you can't see. She's pinging around like a nutter. So yes, now I've removed Mog from my ear. When pet shops get their rats, and this is majority of chain stores, some places breed their own, but the majority of chain stores get their rats from large scale kind of commercial breeders. What a lot of people in the fancy call rodent farms. So they produce all sorts of different animals, and I'm saying produce because they are a factory for producing animals, unlike breeders like me who have much loved pets that lick their ears and are little assholes, and then breed from the best of them to try and improve things. Yes, now she's grooming my hair. It's quite nice. This is quite distracting. So they kind of produce them in these rodent farms. Generally, the animals are crammed together in very small spaces. I'll try and stick some photos in this. I'm not entirely sure what I'm doing with videos, but just to give you a bit of an idea. But yes, very small kind of cages. They don't really have room to stand. They're fed on kind of really low quality lab blocks, just designed to kind of churn out babies as fast as possible. The mums don't get any breaks between litters. They breed multiple litters in their life. I mean, Ellie's had one litter, she won't have another. Partly because she quite enjoyed it, but partly because she didn't have the smoothest birth in the world. But at most, I would say your most ethical breeders would only have maybe two or absolute maximum three from a rat, because it does take a big chunk out of their life and they deserve to have more of a life than just producing babies. And also, they'll generally breed from them when they're old enough rather than. When I say that, when they're old enough, physically rats are old enough to reproduce from about 5 or 6 weeks old. They can get pregnant from them, then 3 weeks later they can pop out the first litter. Little Chocobo here is one of my babies. She is about 6 months old. She won't be having her litter until, I think I'm probably mating her around January, which is quite early for my line. She gets to be a baby and be a kitten and enjoy herself for the majority of her life, and that's important to me. There may be a bang shortly because somebody's gone somewhere they shouldn't, and it's looking precarious. Just excuse me a sec. We've rescued said rat. She really shouldn't be climbing that much, given that she broke her arm a few weeks ago. This is her first full free range, so I'm keeping an eye on her. I don't want to do anything too difficult. Right, so. Yeah, so basically the conditions that the rats are bred in these rodent farms is not nice. There goes that bang. And it's one that I don't think's fair on rats, and it's something that I personally feel real strongly about, that we shouldn't pay money to them, because if you pay money you're saying it's okay. Even if you feel you're rescuing that rat from the pet shop, giving it a good life, you are giving it a good life, but then that frees up space in the tank for the next batch of rats to come in, and another kind of mum has another litter in horrific conditions. Back to back, and it's just the more of us that don't buy from pet shops, the less rats that are going to be born in that kind of environment. Give them like a proper life. Give them chance to enjoy and support. Put your money where your ethics lie. So support what you believe in, be that rescues or good breeders. But make sure whatever you're doing, if you're kind of paying money for rats, that you do it for some kind of good reason. You do it with some thought behind it, even if your choices aren't the same as mine. There are some pet shops that do breed their own, and they generally will breed them in better conditions. They can't get much worse than rodent farms, to be entirely honest. But what I will say is they will not be able to breed effectively for health, and they won't be able to breed effectively for temperament, because they won't keep records on the ones that are sold. And that's quite fundamental for me as a breeder. I hear from my pet homes regularly, and actually what they tell me helps influences my decisions, and good breeders will take that into account. Pet homes are really important to us, kind of part of breeding better rats. pet shops won't be able to do that. So that's my kind of main ethical kind of problem with the ones that breed their own, even if they breed them well. And there are some people that really do have respect for rats and sell them in pet shops. I just don't think that you can properly improve rats. And I think that's, if you're going to breed them rather than kind of support rescues, you want to do it for the good of the rat. You don't want to do it for your own sake, even though it's can be great fun, can be horrible, but can be great fun as well. So that's whereabouts to get them from. So I would always recommend a good breeder or a rescue. And next thing, see if there's anything left of my notes. Okay, what sex? So I keep girls. I used to keep boys, and then before that I kept girls. I think I had a pair of boys in there somewhere in the early days. Basically both sex are brilliant. You can't pick a wrong one. I would like to have some books on hand to kind of demonstrate the physiological differences and show how easy they are to sex. But suffice to say, boys have fairly big balls, they're very obvious, and they don't have, let's see if I can pick a rat that might demonstrate it. Ignore her shaved belly, she had a kind of blood test. So you see on Monster, she has a little kind of hole underneath what her little nub is. That says she's a girl, she has a vagina basically, it's a little hole underneath her urethra. She also has, maybe I'll try Muggle Mug for this, nipples. Now nipples are obvious because they have like little kind of ruffles in the fur. Very easy way to sex the girls. Boys have balls, they can sometimes hide a bit, but they can't hide a penis versus a vagina. Though some pet shops do regularly get it wrong. That's probably another thing to mention on the pet shop thing. The number of pet shop missexing incidents that I've seen are very high. We see them all the time. We deal with them regularly on rat groups. Just don't risk it. And if you do decide to be kind of go for a pet shop rat, get boys, because you can tell the boys and make sure you sex them yourself. But I personally just wouldn't do that at all. So girls are historically meant to be like nutty, crazy. I mean, all my rats are crazy, be the boys or girls. But yes, they're meant to be a lot more active. I would say that is and it isn't true. Girls can be hyper in a way that boys just don't have the same length of energy. They can be just as manic for about an hour, and then they'll usually, particularly as they get past about 6-12 months, usually calm down a bit. My girls can keep going for 4 or 5 hours and they don't really stop. They probably take it in turns to sleep, but you're not really aware of it because it's just all mental. They are a lot more kind of active and crazy. But it does depend on the line. You can get girls that are cuddly, you can get boys that are more hyper than girls. It really does depend on the individual rat and the kind of, if you're getting them from a breeder, their line and what they breed for. So all of mine are going to be crazy, because I like crazy. In terms of health, that does have more obvious kind of differences. So girls are more prone to mammary tumours. They can get pyo, which is womb infection. It's not uncommon, and they also are more prone to pituitary tumours. They're a little cheeky. These are all things that can be fixed apart from the pituitary tumour. You can only kind of just keep them going for as long as possible comfortably on that. But mammary tumours and pyo you can fix with surgery. It's expensive, and that's something to bear in mind. Girls are more expensive to keep than boys. Boys, however, they don't tend to live on average quite as long as girls. The health issues that they more commonly get are things like kidney failure, hind leg degeneration. I mean, girls still get both of those, but they tend to get them later on. They tend to age a little bit slower. Boys are also prone to heart problems. Both sexes can be prone to respiratory problems, particularly if you're getting them from a bad source. I'd say most breeder rats, if you've bred them properly, you can reduce significantly the amount of respiratory problems that they get. So the book's kind of conditions are things that you manage, you can't fix. So that's why they're generally cheaper, but they're not going to live as long because you can't actually fix them like you can the mammary tumours in the girls. And I should say, books can still get mammary tumours. Mammary tumours are basically tumours of breast tissue. Books still have breast tissue, just not nearly as much, and they don't have the hormones that kind of pump it up and make them inflate as quickly. So that's one consideration in terms of health. Probably the most major difference between books and does from me is books need you a little bit more. But that can be actually quite nice when a doe chooses you. You know she's done it because she just loves you. not because she needs you, but it can also be really flattering when you've got a book that just looks at you as though you're his world. They can both be equally good. You're not going to get have a bad choice. Books are more prone to hormonal issues when they hit the teenage phase, but to be fair, it's really quick to fix. You just if it doesn't sort out by putting them in a small cage and giving them time to kind of sort the hierarchy out, then you just castrate them. Does you can spay them, but it's a much more invasive operation, and it doesn't work with the same success rates. We did a bit of a study on one of the rat groups among Rat Care UK recently, and there's some really interesting results on castration nearly always fixed book hormonal problems. Spays sometimes did, so that's one thing to bear in mind. Trying to think if there's any other major things to talk about in terms of the sexes. What I would advise if you're going to get rats from a breeder, because there's quite often a waiting list to get rats from a breeder, and it can be, I'd say 3 months is a short wait. 6 to 12 months is what my wait is, because it's a bit ridiculous at times. I don't want for pet homes, but I do love good pet homes. But generally, you do have a wait with a breeder. Sometimes you get lucky. Not all breeders hold waiting lists. Sometimes you get them quite quickly. If you're ready at the right time and the kind of stars align, it can work really well. But it's not always guaranteed. Sorry. But yes, so it's one to kind of bear in mind. If you're going to a breeder just and you haven't got rats already, don't specify your sex, because both are great. You're going to love either of them. I can guarantee that. But it'll speed up your chances a little bit, because they'll whatever becomes available, you'll kind of have more chance of getting it. So that's in terms of sex. What do you need before getting rats? I would say do your research. Don't just go down to the nearest pet shop and buy the cage they have marked as a rat cage. In some cases, it will actually be a reasonable rat cage, but it's probably going to be quite expensive and not nearly as good as you could get with a bit of research. So cage is quite important. It's your probably your biggest outlay. You're talking about at the cheapest end about 50 quid for a Coco Large, which is a great cage. Fits about five, six rats in comfortably if set up well. You don't really want the wooden shelves that come with it or the ramps, just chuck them. But the cage itself is great quality. And it goes all the way right up to the other end of the scale, which is like my Ventura here, which is about, I don't know, 250 quid. It'll fit, I don't know, about 14 rats in if I set it up really well. I've got 8 in, I think, at the moment. Changes a little bit occasionally. But that kind of scale of cost, and you will get the big cage, the more money you've got to afford, you will kind of get value out of that. I mean, I love this cage, it's a great cage. I love my Coco, which I have for my babies. But I would always prefer a cage that's big, because I can put more stuff in it and I have a lot of stuff for the rats. So that's one of your biggest expenses. It's one to look around. You can get great secondhand cages that might need a bit of TLC in terms of getting the rust off them and painting them with a rust-proof paint, but that's very possible, and it's you can get real bargains for that. I've seen somebody get hold of a cage that's similar size to mine for about, I don't know, 75 quid, and just put a bit of work into cleaning up some of the rust. As an engineer, I'm all up for kind of doing up old cages as well. I quite enjoy that. What else you'll need is you'll need plenty of water bottles. I'd say 2 water bottles is minimum, because what can happen is some of the water bottles can stick or break, so you always want a kind of a choice on there. I put one per level in my cage, and I have a couple of water bowls too, because rats love splashing around in water. But they're kind of ones that hang on the cage, because otherwise they kick loads of crap in it, and they still kick loads of crap in it, but slightly less if it's hung. Next bit, hammocks. Rats love hammocks. There is a wide choice of hammocks out there. I would say to start off with, get yourself a couple per, and then a couple of changes. Go along to shows, there's normally hammock stalls there, but when you're starting out with them, go for open hammocks. As the rats settle in and get used to you, then you can start getting kind of little cubes and kind of more enclosed hammocks that they'll really enjoy. But at first, you want them to kind of get used to you with and the noises that happen around them, and open hammocks are best for that. You want active things to set up the cage, and at some point I'll do a kind of probably several videos on different kind of layouts and toys and stuff that you can use. Ropes are great, branches is what I love. I have a lot of branches in my cage. you want things like perches and parrot toys. I will say, don't spend lots of money on rat specific items. You're probably going to find better stuff for cheaper in your local IKEA, in an online parrot store, from kind of some of the more specialist things. Like, I love mini pets and Scarlet's parrots and Northern parrots, the three places that I hit quite a lot for my rat stuff. Oh no, Muggle the Mug is on the camera stand. She's just trouble today, isn't she? So get yourself a, kind of a selection of bits and bobs, but understand that you're going to accumulate better bits and bobs as you go along. Pound shops are also great places to get things. Dog rope toys can be adapted rather than spending a small fortune on a rat specific rope, which is probably just gonna annoy you. So what's next? Oh, carrier. Carrier is very important. When you go and pick your rats up, you want a good carrier. I would say probably the best carrier you can get is actually a mini cage. So these are the cages that are sold that are highly inappropriate for hamsters, and that are about so big. Great for intros, great for a hospital cage, great for carrying between places. Put them in like a large IKEA bag or something to give them a bit of shelter if you're going on public transport or something, rather than a cage and a car. But they're brilliant, and you can hang a little hammock and a water bottle in them, so I would generally recommend those. You can pick them up. Now she's learned how to climb on the camera stand, she's going to keep doing it. You can pick them up cheaply secondhand, usually for about 5-10 quid, or you can buy kind of proper ones for about 20-30 quid. Next thing is, you need to think about substrate. There's a lot of good substrates out there. I won't go to it in depth because, again, I could do a whole video on that. But get a decent one that's low dust. Go for substrate over fleece. Fleece stinks and does not absorb nearly as well as a decent substrate. Talking about probably the best ones are chopped card or a kind of dust extracted, heat treated shaving. Go for a decent quality horse one. Shavings are kind of, can be bad or they can be really good. Or kind of a hemp based bedding, they're quite good as well. You might want to go for a litter as well, because rats are very able to be litter trained. Go for something like a paper cat litter, so, or a paper small animal litter. Don't go for a wood litter or a clay litter. Brands like Breeder Select, Paper Lit, or Back to Nature are great. Next one, nesting. Nesting material can be as simple as some torn up kitchen roll or newspaper. And I should say, newspaper in the UK is non-toxic print, all of it. Watch it if you're in another country. But they love making things with nesting. Just tear it up, put it in a pile at the bottom of the cage, and they'll put it where they want to do. Or some dust-free hay. I quite like using hay, but it has to be really decent quality and dust-free, because some of it is going to cause problems. And then finally, food. Get them a decent diet. I've recently done a video on how to make a really simple mix of your own. You can also buy ready-made good quality mixes from places like Rat Rations, which I do frequent quite a lot. That's another good place to get bits and pieces for your cage from, and substrate from as well. Postage and packaging seems a bit daunting, but by the time you've got your food, you've got your substrate, you've got some bedding and some toys, it's actually not bad. Buy in bulk and it'll last you for a while. So those are the main things that you want to think about buying in order to get set up. And I would say, if you're going to a breeder or even like an experienced rat rescuer, they will help you. So have a chat with them, find out what kind of things they would recommend. They might even help line you up with a good secondhand cage. So what quite often happens in my group is one of my pet homes might upgrade their cage, and they'll contact me and ask, is there anybody that they could sell their first cage to? And I'll usually put them in front of somebody that's kind of applying to me at the time to join my waiting list. And a lot of breeders do similar. It's or even sell some of their previous cages, or they might take in some rescues and be given a cage with them, and then kind of pass on the cage to somebody in need, usually the person that's taking the rescues. I should add that breeders often ask places to take in rescues and can help you find a good rescue too. If they kind of got the time on their hands and such to kind of keep rescues as well as their own rats. So there's a lot of interest in my ears today. I really don't know what makes them smell so nice. So I think I've covered all the topics I set out to cover. It's quite a long video, so I should probably tie up now because you're probably bored out of your mind. The girls are still quite enjoying it. I would definitely say if you're kind of serious, if you're prepared for the absolute mayhem they will make of your life and the fact that they're slightly addictive and you'll spend far too much money. I should add on this, rats are not cheap pets. Vet bills do add up very quickly. I dread to think how much I've spent in the past month on two rats, one with a pituitary tumour, one with a kind of broken leg. I must have spent 500 quid-ish easily in the past month on two rats. Not every month's like that, but they can cost you a lot. If you need emergency vet care, you're talking a similar amount just for one visit, that they're probably not going to fix the problem, just tidy it over. You do need to bear in mind that rats are not cheap. People think they're cheap because you can buy them for, I don't know, 30, 35 quid for a pair from a good breeder, but they're not, because it will add up, the vet bills will add up, the inability to not buy really cute hammocks will add up. The fact you'll end up travelling around the country to go to shows will add up. You might not everybody likes shows, but I love them. It ends up being not a cheap hobby. They are well worth it, I think. I absolutely adore them and do think they're the best pet out there for anybody, though I'd still think dogs are great too. And probably cats, maybe. And the cat yet, or a dog. But I do think they're the best kind of small animal pet you can get, and they teach you so much, and they just keep you so entertained, and they're just funny little souls. Definitely recommend them, but just make sure when you go into it, you're going into it with your eyes open, that you do your time, you do your research. I would really recommend joining something like one of your local clubs and going along to some shows, and or joining a decent Facebook group like Rat Care UK, which is one that I help a lot out on. There are other Facebook groups as well. Just bear in mind that not everybody on there actually knows what they're talking about, and there's always some drama, because social media wouldn't be social media without its drama. But yes, do your research, read up, talk to people. There's a lot of great people out there that will be fully prepared to help you out. Meet rats. So when you're trying to pick which sex to meet or which breeder to get your rats from, go along to a show and meet several different rats and see which suit you best. Not every rat will suit every person. Not every person will suit every rat. But yeah, enjoy them. But go into it prepared, and you'll enjoy them that much more. You don't want to feel out of your depth, and you don't want to kind of have those really magical moments ruined by it not being, you're not being kind of ready, or they're not being kind of well sociable, socialized, lovable rats, if that's what you need in a rat. But best of luck, and I hope you do go for rats, and I hope that you do enjoy them just as much as I have. Hopefully you won't become quite as obsessed with them, though it is a good hobby if you're going to pick one. Rats is not a bad one for it. So thank you, and let's see what my next video is.